God, we are entering into a new series, and this series is based on a book. You may have heard of the book. The book is by Dave Ramsey. It's called The Total Money Makeover. Now I'm going to summarize the book for you. You ready? Debt is dangerous and potentially deadly. That's the summary. Debt is dangerous and potentially deadly. Now, I do want to acknowledge that there may be persons in here, you just absolutely wealthy. You don't have any debt at all. But this is still helpful because what we want to do is we want to share the message with those who are younger, those who are in their 20s and 30s and 40s and 50s, and encourage them to make good decisions, to really think strategically before saying, I gotta get it, I gotta get it, I gotta get it. Amen. And we'll talk about why. So let's start by turning to Deuteronomy chapter 8 and chapter 8. Verse 18, this is and I want you guys to help me if I forget. So if I forget, I want you to help me. But every time we gather for this series, which will last this month, and next month, I'm sorry. Every time we gather for this series, I want you to remind me if I forget that we're starting with this verse. This verse teaches us something very valuable about all that we have, all resources, and all that we need. All that we have, all that we want, all that we need. This verse here teaches us a lot about it. I think this is a very fundamental verse, a powerful verse. This is a very fundamental verse. This is a fundamental verse, a very powerful verse. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. It's great to see your beautiful faces. Y'all look good. Y'all should be modeling something. I don't know what. Maybe it's modeling joy. That's what happens.
Yeah.
This is what joy looks like. Amen. Now, your smile is extra big because you're getting ready to retire. Anytime you get ready to retire, you start to say, whoa. Amen. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. And I'm going to read about, I want you to read it with me. I'm not making this up, I promise you. This is from the Bible. This is from God. He means this. It says, but remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms his covenant, which he swore to your forefathers as it is today. All right, I'm going to read it one more time. You can read it with me too. Come on, guys, it's the Bible. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms his covenant, which he swore to your forefathers as it is today. All right, what does that mean? You said two parts. So you said that what we have come from God, but you said another part. Okay. And so this is for sometimes we feel like, you know what, I don't have what I want, I don't have what I need. And God says, well, I'm giving you the ability to go do something. And it could be, hey, you know, I knew a man who got a bucket and some water and started washing windows. I mean, you know, there's a lot of windows up down the street. Whatever it is, you might be a typist in college. I type, yes. The power, the impetus, thank you, the possibility for us to be, and it says to produce, to be productive. And I do believe, and I know that, I believe you believe, that every human being, God, is called to be productive in some way or another. So I want to use that verse just to keep reminding us, because one of the things about the book, Dave Ramsey's book, is he starts off by saying, this is not a get-rich-quick scheme. Mm-hmm. This is not something that you're going to get, and tomorrow you're going to have everything you want. He said, no. And he explains, and I'll go into the lesson. Good to see you, brother. He explains his testimony this way. He says that he became a millionaire through real estate deals. Mm-hmm. He would get a loan, buy a house, flip the house, rent the house. I mean, he had so much money, he was a millionaire. And he said he loved Jaguars. Any Jaguar drivers or lovers? I went to school with a brother who loved the Jaguar so much. He had this Jaguar that was so beat up, stuff was falling off, but he felt so good. Kept thinking to myself, sell that thing and get a car that actually runs. But so he was a millionaire, Dave Ramsey, all on debt, you know, and he went bankrupt. He lost everything. He couldn't pay his bills, couldn't feed his family. So eventually he figured out, maybe the best thing for me to do is not to build a house of cards or live on debt, but to build a business that's not based on debt. Amen? And that's true. If you know anything about American finances, you know that our finances tend to be pretty debt-driven. In America, people depth. But I want to start by just letting you know the first five chapters of Total Money Makeover focuses primarily on psychological hurdles. When I say psychological hurdles, that's basically thoughts that keep us trapped. We got these bad thoughts. And whenever you have bad thoughts, you can have bad actions. All right, so here are some of the thoughts. First, let me tell you, are you familiar with the types of debt? What are the two types of debt? If you had to summarize the types of debt, there are two major types of debt in finance. All right, that's good, that's good. I like that, I'm gonna use it. Assess the debt and one debt. Okay, but we're looking for another term here that deals with financing. So if you go to a financial institution, they'll give you two different types of loans based on these types of debt.
Long term?
Okay, long term and short term is one. Very good. All right. Y'all got your hand?
Okay, I'm
gonna
have a hand.
Y'all don't have a hand?
Yeah, I got my hand.
There are at least a couple in the back. I thought I had extra, but they disappeared. That's fine. On the back last pew against the wall, there should be something. So let me tell you, the two major types of debt, I feel good now because now y'all can't read. The two major types of debt is first, secured debt and unsecured debt. Well, what's the difference between secured debt and unsecured debt? Well, if something is, anybody want to tell us what secured debt is? I thought we already had some, but if you ask her to make copies, that would help. Just in the office. So there's two types of debt, secured and unsecured. Now, please let me give you a picture. Give me an example of something that is secured debt. Give me an example. He said a house and a car. Those are the two examples. For the most part, those are the two examples. Now, if you got some really nice shoes, that really won't work. You got a nice suit, it won't work.
Is this the right one that says a dog on the light thing that I do to save every time?
Read the first line.
God on light thing to save evil one.
No, that's not the right one. I'll have to get it to you later. I apologize, y'all. Forgive me. So there's two types of debt. Now, so when you talk about those two, the secured debt, it's typically a car or a house. Now let me warn you and argue with you that a car is not the same as a house. Because as soon as you take a car off the car lot, it depreciates. It's lost much of its value. Now I got some great car salespersons who are members here, and they're wonderful people. But when they tell you that you're getting a car and it's going to hold its value, that's not true. It's not true. Cars don't hold value. So a car is not the best example. If you drive off the lot and you say, I'm going to pay $20,000, you can't go and turn it in and get that $20,000 back. You can probably get about $12,000 back. Now, a house, on the other hand, is secure. When I say a house, I don't mean necessarily a house. Any piece of property, you can do something with. And I'll tell you why. My grandfather used to say that property is the only thing that not make it more. So that's secure debt. So if you have anything like that, you can use it to get something cool. All right? So the truth is, even if it's secure debt, you need to know that all debt is potentially dangerous and even deadly. And I'm going to show you what the Bible says about that, not just what he says about it. Let me give you three reasons, and these aren't from the book. These are just things that the Bible teaches us in terms of thinking about that. There are three reasons that all debt is dangerous and potentially deadly. The first reason, debt is deadly because it strangles our ability to show love and compassion, or in other words, sympathy, as you feel like you have, or sympathy. In other words, we can't show sympathy with our finances when we're in deep debt. Let me prove it to you. Turn to Luke chapter 10, verse 35 and 37. Here's a story that you know, you can probably recite it from memory. Everybody in here can tell this story from memory. But we often forget Luke chapter 10, verse 25 through 37. There should be a Bible right in front of you. Luke chapter 10, verse 25 through 37. A lot of us know this verse really, really well, but I think we often forget a major component of this story.
Luke chapter 10, where are we at?
Verse 25. We know the story, but we often forget that in Luke chapter 10, verse 25 through 37, it's not just a story of a man with a good heart. Let me show you. It's not just a story of a man with a good heart. That's a major part of it. But there's more to it than a man, than just a man with a good heart. So I'm at Luke. Luke chapter 10. Amen. And I'll begin reading at verse 25. Now I'm going to skip a little bit through it because I know that we know some of it. Luke chapter 10, verse 25. On one occasion, an expert of the law stood up to Jesus to test him. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He said, "What is written in the law?" He replied. "How do you read it?" he answered. "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." "You have answered correctly," Jesus replied. "Do this and you will live." But he wanted to justify himself. So he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" In reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he fell into the hands of robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road. And when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to place and saw him pass by on the other side. But the Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was. And when he saw him, he took pity on him and sympathy on him. He went to him, bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his donkey, took him to an inn, took care of him. The next day he took out two silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him," he said. "Safe passage." Oops, I'm sorry, I skipped the verse. "And when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense." All right. So why did we read that story? We're talking about why debt is dangerous. And remember we said it prevents you from showing mercy, compassion. Now, I know some of you in here very well. I know some of you here somewhat well, right? But the truth is, all of us from time to time have had friends in our life, have known someone. Let me use myself as an example, even our own children. And so when the Lord gives us resources, we're able to be good to people, to bless people. I did not turn in my son's field trip form on yesterday, or at least weeks ago. And so they told me, "Well, he can't go." I said, "Wait, you don't do that to my boy like that. You don't do that to him. Let him go on the field trip." I said, "No." And the field trip was all the way in Williamsburg. In addition to being in Williamsburg, it was at Jamestown. It was like $20 a person. I said, "Baby, I want to take it. We had the extra money. And I can take it. We had such a good time." He smiled. "Dad, you're a great dad." Yeah, because the truth is, one of the ways we're able to show love to people is with resources. If you see a hungry person, you can say, "Well, God blessed you. I pray for you." They're still hungry. So one of the reasons we need to handle our finances with such wisdom and sagacity and restraint is so that we can be a blessing to others. One of the best ways to show love to people is through resources. Through resources. Somebody doesn't have feet on? Help them with feet. Somebody needs to go back to school? Help them buy a book. Truth be told, we all know that. But we can't do that if we've tied up everything we have. If I'm dying in debt, I can't give anything to anybody. Don't call me for anything. I'm sinking myself. Let me prove it to you. That text didn't prove it to you. I know this one will. Turn to Matthew chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18. So don't forget, when you look at the Good Samaritan, when you look at the Good Samaritan, don't just look at a person with a good heart. Look at a person with a good heart and somebody who has something in their hand. Somebody who had some resource in their hand. Matthew chapter 18, verse 21 through 35, and I won't read this whole part to you, but it's Matthew chapter 18, verse 21. And keep in mind our first verse was it's God who gives us the ability to get wealth, to get resources. And when I say ability, that doesn't mean that he's going to drop money down from the sky. It means that he's going to show us how to work, how to maneuver in a way that's pleasing to him to get resources. Matthew chapter 18, I said start at verse 21, And I'm going to skip through this one because I know you know this one as well. Let's get down. Verse 23. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. That meant he was going to go into slavery. Verse 26, because of debt. The servant fell on his knees before him. Be patient with me, he begged. I'll pay you back everything. The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. He literally said, everything you owe me, you don't owe me. Cancel. He didn't just say, I'll give you more time. He said, hey, no more. Verse 28. But when the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. So basically, he owed one man $1 million, and another man owed him $1.50, right? And when he found this man who owed him $1.50, he grabbed him, verse 28, and he began choking him and shaking him. You better pay me my $1.50, man. Don't mess with me. He demanded his money. He's shaking, spitting. Pay me my money. Now, why did I show this to you? I want to show you the contrast between when you have resources, how you can engage people. I mean, if you're strapped, if you don't have a penny to your name, it's really difficult to be gracious. If somebody borrows lunch money from you, you're going to call them for a whole month trying to get your lunch money back. Now, y'all laugh, but we all know some people, we've had some interactions with, somebody got some family members, and they say things like, the last time I loaned that jackleg money, I saw him on Facebook on a cruise. And I loaned him, I'm testifying. I loaned him, I didn't have enough money. I got all these kids. I didn't have, but I gave a little bit. And I see him on a cruise. Never again. And that was about 7 years ago. Okay. And so the point is, when we have, we deal differently than when we don't have. When we're broke, when we're deep in debt, we can't deal with people we want to in Congress. Who knows the name Manute Bol? Anybody know the name Manute Bol? Amen, my brother. Manute Bol, who is he? NBA star. Yeah, an NBA man. And he was 7 feet tall and 7 inches. Somebody said he was a human fly swatter because he would just pack people. And then he'd go like this. No. Well, they're disagreeing records, but some say he gave $4 million, and others say he gave $6 million to where he was from. And he was from a very hurtful place. He was from Sudan. And they were ravaged by war. Manute Bol said, God gave me this job so I could look back and help somebody. Now, you may not have $6 million,